mulch on the centre box over. And I've spoken to Mark briefly today, and I know he's coming to the next meeting to probably discuss further around arrangements. So I'm really not switching on the safety wall problem, so we're having what we're trying to achieve. We'll get to that later in the presentation, and see if any questions about that's okay. So, what I was going to do was to just give you, I have presented a number of screening committees, just give you a bit of a whistle-stop tour of the arrangements following the implementation of what we've called the Community First Operating Model. But basically in January this year, we changed our structure and went from a geographical-based structure, which a lot of you may be familiar with an area commander in charge of all the resources in the Wirral, to a functional model with a number of commands sitting at the centre, really. So the first arrangement is, I have presented a number of places which is to remind people, because it helps paint the picture of who's got responsibility at the local level around safeguarding, if that's okay. I'm afraid you'll find it comes very small, so I'm just going to put in the general direction of the picture, and it's sort of different departments to add in as we go, so bear me a second. So you don't need to read what's on it, but all I need to say, anything in the top left hand corner is based as a force level, or a force level footprint. Anything in the bottom left hand corner has got the local footprint, and I'll talk through what they are. So this first element is what we call response and resolution. This is our emergency response. So they're now basically the four hubs across the whole of Merseyside, Wallasey being one of those hubs. They can respond to 999 calls 24/7 anywhere in Merseyside. The reality of that is, rural patrols generally stay in Wirral. And in fact, because of the volume of calls, more patrols come from Liverpool to us than we go from this side over there, because they can draw resources in from those and set up for areas anywhere. These elements is our investigation elements, and this has got partial footprint at force level around our protecting vulnerable people. We have analytical capability, month, there is a meetings, a series of meetings to come together as a force level with representation across all the local authority areas, usually at either my level or chief inspector. Certainly have CIB representation at detective chief inspector, as it. And we go through the case studies. One of the areas we look at is the sexual exploitation of individuals, criminal exploitation, harmful practices around forced marriage, FGM, and that type of thing. And then the other side of things we look at, how we're targeting racial sex offenders. We look at where sex offences are committed against vulnerable people, and also domestic abuse and the impact of domestic abuse within the family setting. I mentioned county lines there before. Another thing that's termed, you may have heard or I don't know if you've heard of, is called cookery. And this is where vulnerable individuals who are targeted, who have got access to properties, so they may have a resident, get housing allowance or whatever, but they're vulnerable in themselves. So other people target them to store drugs, guns, use their houses as parties, throw it to and fro, because obviously those people who are using that craft phone are not going back to their own address to get those drugs. They've got hands all over the place, and often it's within vulnerable individuals' properties. And we've used legislation in the last 6 months where we have the power to exclude people from properties depending on what evidence we gather. And that's where we work closely with the Wirral Social Behaviour Team. And we look at what we can actually get in statement form, but also what we can get out of diary sheets, what we can pick up off our incident logs, and we overlay all that information to put into a civil court environment to say, on balance, we need to provide some protection around this particular location. So again, we're just trying to target the vulnerable women, as I said, women and children within that particular environment. So our response is based on what we call 4 P's, and this is emanated from the counter-terrorism strategy, moved into serious and organised crime strategy, and obviously the 4 P's ahead of there, and pursue the prevention and attack. Pursue very much, I suppose, historically, how the police would be perceived around interventions, locking people up and getting in the criminal justice system. But I like to think that we've moved on a little bit since then. We work effectively with partners, obviously we're in schools, we look at a variety of legislation, we look at trying to educate people who get involved, we look at trying to dismantle groups to prevent the negative role models, and we look at supporting those that are vulnerable, and very much working together, because we need to have an understanding of the demand that we're creating for the partners and partners are creating for us, where that fits into and what can be delivered on individual special needs. So at the very top end, cases will be referred into MASH, and obviously there will be work wrapped around that, around how we can protect those vulnerable people. But more locally, we've had delivery of training to our police community support officers, frontline local policing officers, so they know when they go into specific environments, family settings, they can pick up on issues that might be affecting the children within those environments, and they can make appropriate referrals through, and that will enable some level of early help to be involved, so people don't end up going down to criminality or a number of other impact factors that might happen that affect their life chances. So I mentioned obviously the operational response on some of the agencies that we're involved with. As a separate piece of the reckon